This week, we're in Wilmington, Delaware, where someone here will have their personal treasure selected for display at the National Geographic Museum in Washington, D.C.
What is this?
We don't exactly know.
It is a sampler. It was stitched in 1803.
I would say this is a $20,000 document.
Wow.
As a historical piece, this is a great, great find.
Game going. I'm Curt Doussett.
I'm Kinga Phillipps. Yeah! We're searching the country for items with fascinating history.
This is George Washington's actual signature.
This was possibly made by Thomas Edison. This is the gun that killed Alexander Hamilton.
And objects with unexpected value.
Between $20,000 and $25,000.
Oh, what? My God.
$80,000.
The object that most belongs in a museum is...
We're on the hunt for America's lost treasures. This week, people from all over Delaware have brought their treasured heirlooms and artifacts to the beautiful Winterthur Museum.
I just brought my Rip that I've had for 40 years, and we hope to show him off in there.
This is officer's uniform jacket from the War of 1812.
It would pay for part of college to win this thing, so that would be big news for me.
I think it's just a wonderful opportunity for a bunch of us to show off some things that have been hidden away for years, and probably some of them we don't even know what they are.
I'm just really excited about this. I want to win.
All right, everyone, welcome to America's Lost Treasures. Thank you for coming out today here in Wilmington, Delaware, to the Winterthur Museum. Now, Kinga and I are going to come out and see the items that you've brought in, and we're going to get to know you as well.
Now, Curt and I will each be choosing three items for further investigation, and then by the end of the week, one of you will be selected to share your item with the world at the National Geographic Museum in Washington, D.C.
Let's see your old stuff. Tell me what this is.
This is a 1963 Mack. It's a big, heavy hauler. It's a kind of truck that, as a kid growing up, I always loved and wanted to have one. And I saw this for sale, and I decided to buy it and have it restored.
Yeah, it's a cool truck, but how is it a treasure?
Remember that there were a lot of construction projects going on in the 50s and 60s. We had Eisenhower's highway program. A lot of these trucks were used to build the highway. I-95, for instance.
Okay, what's the history behind this?
This truck belonged to the Thomas Proctor Company. They built all the docks, jetties, seawalls, and sewer plants up and down the New Jersey coast. These kinds of vehicles are really important for me, and I think important for people in general.
These trucks were truly America's workhorses.
Folks in New Jersey, when they see this truck, they run over because it takes them back to their childhood when they were kids. It's like a time machine.
I would love to see this. I mean, it looks great here in the picture, but...
Wait till you see it.
I want to see it. I want to see this. This is
phenomenal. This will knock you out. It'll blow you away.
That's a big 10-4.
That is beautiful.
It is beautiful.
I have to be honest. I don't know what it is.
Well, this is a 19th century liquor chest.
Liquor chest.
You open it up, it's got six hand-blown square bottles. It belonged to my great-grandfather, my grandmother's father, who lived in Houston, Texas, and he went into the Civil War in 1861, and the family story is that he carried this during the Civil War. This is a picture of him.
It's a handsome man.
Yeah. But it's very pretty. It has almost a wallpaper covering in the lid and in the inserts. He was a lieutenant colonel, but even for an officer, it's hard to believe that somebody would carry something this elegant. And I did find a citation from a war diary of one of his enlisted men who said that when he left, nobody was unhappy. He wasn't very well liked. So I thought, well, maybe if he's whipping this thing out and flaunting his liquor box in front of the troops, it didn't endear them to him. So,
especially if he didn't share. A battlefield minibar from the Civil War? I'll drink to that.
You've got scales here. These look like really precise old scales? What is this?
This is what they would call a semi-micro analytical balance for a hundredth of a milligram. That's why the glass is all around it, to keep the wind from bothering it.
So you can get really, really minute here with the things you're sticking
right
in there.
Right, very, very precise, like a human hair. It was made in 1943. And the all cool right thing is the property tag over here says AEC, that I think means Atomic Energy Commission. And that could mean this was used in the Manhattan Project. That's why I'm excited about
really
it.
Really?
Yeah.
You know, I want to grab one of our appraisers. Hey, Glenn, can I borrow you for a second? Come on in, man.
They are relatively common. They're a neat, you know, focal point, you know, for an item to talk about and things like that.
How much did you spend on this when you got it?
About $275.
You know, value today, you're probably looking $300 to $500, you know, in that mm-hmm range, maybe a little more. Now, if you could tie that to the Manhattan Project or something, now, you know, you could, that would, you know, tenfold or something like that. It could be very, very,
that much.
Very
great
neat.
Yeah. Is there a way to get government contract information of when they bought
the government's
items?
Really open with all their files. That shouldn't be too hard, right? Sure. Precision balances like this were used in critical projects to measure mass down to 1/10,000th of a gram. But with no way to verify its provenance, I'm going to weigh my other options.
I think I see Curt over there. That's way too close of a view of Curt.
We inherited it almost 30 years ago from a great aunt. Unfortunately, we don't know a lot about the telescope itself other than it came through the family.
I know who's going to be able to tell us more is one of our experts. Can you come over here, Joe?
Thank you.
Have
How you
a
doing?
Look
Very good, thank you.
At this spectacular telescope.
This is a wonderful piece, made in London, day and night. So it gives you the opportunity to both use it for a day telescope
right
or for the evening looking at the stars for celestial navigation.
What kind of period are we talking about here?
I would put from really the 1840s up until probably the 1890s, probably naval.
What would the value of something like this be?
Well, a piece like this can range between $400 and $800.
Mm-hmm.
But you've got a wonderful piece here.
Well, thank you very much.
Certainly a wonderful heirloom.
Neat telescope, but without a clear history, it's hard to focus on its significance.
Tell me what you've brought in here. This looks like something I used to be terrified of as a child.
I inherited this from a friend of mine whose mother was an antiques dealer. And all I know is that he had it hanging in his kitchen and he thought it was a discipline paddle.
What do you know about this?
I had a theory that it may have been a bread peel used to slide bread in and out of like a beehive oven. I don't know what it is. So.
Okay, I'm gonna grab one of my appraisers here. Hey, Eric. Okay, Eric, what are you looking for?
Well, I'm looking for the date here, which is 1684, and I see this pinwheel design.
Uh-huh.
It also has been framed and bordered off, and there's a crisscross hatch type decoration down
there's
here.
There's one there,
and
there's
one here.
There,
that's
yeah
correct. And you'll see that it's smooth on this side, and then there's a little bit of a circular smoothness to it on this direction here.
Okay.
It was used in bed clothing after they would make the bed with a quilt or something like that. They would roll this right across it, and it smoothed the bed linens. And this is
a
smoothing board.
That's it, just
for bed linens.
A bed linen smoothing board.
That's correct.
Now, what would be an approximate value of something like this?
For an advanced collector, we'd probably be somewhere in around the $700 to $900 level. They're actually very sought after because they're not a common item.
Well, it's certainly an interesting item. I've never seen anything like it before. Unfortunately, it's just, you know, a board for bed, so I'm not sure it's America's lost treasure.
That is a walking stick, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, it is.
And I bet you it has a great story.
This is the walking stick that belonged to Governor Andrew Gregg Curtin. He was governor of Pennsylvania during the Civil War.
And is he someone of significance to you?
He is my great-great-great-grandfather. Apparently, he was 6'4", a very dashing man.
Very dashing indeed.
This cane was given to him by the governor of Rhode Island. Written on the cane is the Charter Oak, and I believe the Charter Oak is the symbol of Connecticut. It's the tree that's on the quarter.
And what is the significance of the Charter Oak?
It's a tree that was close to 500 years old, and it stood right in the center of Hartford. Each colony had a governing charter that was given to it by the King of England, and in 1687 it was decided that those charters were granted too much independence to the colonies, and so they tried to collect all the charters, and they knew the British were coming to raid the inn where it was, and they rolled it up and stuffed it in the charter oak tree. Well, I've always felt it was very light in weight.
Yeah.
So I have been curious to know if it's hollow. And since the charter oak once stored a famous document, I've always been wondering if it's hollow, what could be in it. So.
I love that mystery. You almost just want to shake it a little bit, see if there's anything in there. The Winterthur Museum has a renowned conservation school. They'll have the equipment to tell me if there's more to this cane than meets the eye.
Okay, here we are. We're on the lower level, and I'm going to take you into our wood shop.
This is where the x-ray magic happens.
Shot will be less than a minute at a fairly low KV, or energy level. Now this will sit on the floor on top of a plate. If the cane is hollow, you would expect to see dark in the middle and lighter on the outside edges.
Jennifer, how are you feeling?
Oh, I don't know, I'm very excited.
We have the image here to look at. My estimation is that it's not a hollow cane, that it looks like a solid piece of wood. It's denser in the middle, as you would expect a cylindrical piece of wood to look.
Right.
So I think we might have our answer here.
Solid cane, then?
It's a solid cane.
Yeah, it looks
cane.
Like it's a solid cane.
But a great history.
Yeah,
it
that's
is a great,
exciting.
It's a great
yes,
piece.
Thank you so much for that.
Oh, you're welcome.
So it turns out the cane was not hollow, but at least we helped Jennifer answer her question, and I have to get back to work.
All right, ladies, are you guys sisters? What is this?
No.
We don't exactly know.
Have you laid on it?
It kind of looks like a little lounge chair, maybe.
We had a lot of fun trying to figure out what it was.
Yeah.
So some people thought perhaps it was from like a turn of the century resort, a lounge by the pool.
And where did you get it?
Well, it was given to me by my daughter-in-law. And she knows I like old furniture, so she found it in a consignment shop.
In Plymouth, Michigan.
When she got it, what did they think it was?
You know, the owner of the store, she told me he did not know what it was and he wanted to get this out of the shop, so it was actually reduced.
A perplexing eyesore that is hard to get rid of? That is the perfect gift for a mother-in-law. Hey, Jojo, they're not sure what it is. It obviously looks like some kind of cot.
Manufacturer labels on the other side.
Let me take a
it
look.
Does say Michigan. I think it's Grand Rapids.
It's not a camp cot, not a Civil War bed.
Uh-oh.
We're at the Winterthur Museum in Wilmington, Delaware, where people are hoping to have their personal treasures selected for display at the National Geographic Museum in Washington, D.C.
Well, actually, it's very becoming on you.
So far, we've seen items of beauty, history, science, and this one. They're not sure what it is. It obviously looks like some kind of cot.
Manufacturer labels on the other side.
Let me take a look.
It does say Michigan. I think it's Grand Rapids.
It's not a camp cot, not a Civil War bed. It's actually an embalmer's table. This manufacturer made these around 1870 to about 1900.
Wow.
And at that period, not everybody went to the funeral home.
Okay.
The funeral director, the embalmer, went to your house where they would do the work and then bring you back, have the service.
So that's not water damage then?
I don't know.
I don't know if it was used, you know? I mean,
It looks like
it
was.
But it's a great conversation piece.
Okay.
I've seen these go for sale between $300 and $800.
Okay.
But it really depends on the buyer.
Right.
I'll be passing on the embalmer's table.
That is beautiful.
Thank you.
What is it?
It is a sampler. It was stitched by Mary Harrington when she was 11 years old in 1803.
That is one talented 11-year-old.
You're not kidding.
Now, was she an ancestor of yours?
Mary was not a direct ancestor, but a younger sister was.
You said it was a sampler, and I'm not too familiar with that. I've heard of them, and what I know about them is that they're very unique.
Well,
tell me more about the history.
It's the needlework that middle-class girls, at least in New England, had to do. You know, you had to prove that you were good at this so that you were marriageable.
I would not be very good marriage material because I could not make something like this.
But you didn't live in 1803 either, so...
Things have changed.
They have indeed.
I need a better understanding of samplers. Luckily, the Winterthur has an extensive collection of them, and Linda Eaton, the senior curator of textiles, is going to help me out.
So samplers were done primarily in schools. This needlework, it represents their education and were often passed down through the women's side of the family. They really represent some important visual sources for interpreting women's history and everyone's history.
So there's a pretty profound historical significance to these samplers.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a nerdy historian. I mean, some people just love them because they're pretty, right? Which I do too.
It's historically significant and it's pretty. So I'm going with the sampler.
This is a discharge paper for a Revolutionary War soldier. It's been hanging in my home for 50 years.
Well, tell me about the signatures that we have here.
This in the center is George Washington. He was, of course, the chief of the army.
This is George Washington's actual signature?
As far as I know. And then the soldier's name.
This looks like William.
William is about all we're able to decipher.
Something Uddenberg.
We got the bird, but we haven't been able to trace it. It came from my grandfather. We've always had a place of honor for it, but we haven't known a lot about it.
And where did he get it?
Well, that's also a mystery. But it would be really fascinating to know what this soldier did during the Revolutionary War.
Wow. Okay, good.
Fascinating?
Very, very much so. We've got George Washington. We got a mystery right up here. We're going to find out who that is.
I would hope you can.
George Washington's John Hancock. That's a good sign.
I know what this is.
You do?
But I bet this has a very interesting story. Where did this come from?
Actually, my grandmother passed away in 1988, and we found it in her attic when we were cleaning it out. So we really don't know where it came from, but I think if I had to assume it would have been my great-grandfather, her father. Lifts
look
off.
At that.
And I love the monogram on the front. It actually labels Graphophone and Columbia Phonograph, New York and Paris. The horn actually settles on over there. And then the wax records would actually slide onto the sleeve.
Can I take a look at this?
Sure, sure.
The wax records. That.
And a beautiful picture of Thomas Edison on the cover.
Look at that. Registered in U.S. Patent Office August 9th, 1904.
I really don't know much about the value of it or the history behind it. Where they were manufactured.
I think that this is something that would really benefit from an expert taking a look at it.
I would love that.
Someone who knows the history.
Mm-hmm.
The graphophone marks the infancy of recorded sound, something most of us can't live without. I'm definitely hitting play on this one.
This is beautiful. I saw this from across the room. I wanted to come over and find out a little bit more about it.
Thank you.
What is this?
This is a silver wine goblet. This cup belonged to Jack's father. A friend of his, we think, had given him the cup. And when Jack's dad died in 1970, we were lucky enough to get this cup. We keep it in our dining room on display in our break front. And we've used it on holidays, for example, for Passover. Because the cup did belong to a Jewish gentleman. It's inscribed.
Oh, there's some writing on there. Okay.
Yes, there is writing on the cup. It says Reverend Isaac Leeser.
And do you know who this Isaac Leeser is? Okay.
Well, we know a little bit about him. Okay. We know that he acted as a rabbi.
Air lighting.
The decoration on here is a hand-chased decoration. It's done by a very, very capable silversmith. The markings here, there is a marking up on the bottom, and it says the word coin.
Wait a minute, it says coin?
Right up in there. And what that is that this is not made of sterling silver, but made of coin silver. And what that is they physically melted coins to be able to produce this product. And it was very common, and it actually, in my mind, adds to the piece's value. Overall, it's just a wonderful, wonderful cup. I think it's a very, very fine piece.
Something about this goblet is speaking to me. Hopefully, the name on it leads me to the promised land. All right, time's up. Kinga and I have to decide which objects could be the lost treasure we're looking for.
Oh, Winterthur really brought the goods, didn't it?
You came across.
A liquor caddy that apparently belonged to this lieutenant colonel during the Civil War who was hated by his men, so the story is spectacular.
Almost as cool as my Mack truck, 63. I just gotta find out how rare it is, so.
I also have a graphophone, which to me is just such a fascinating piece of musical history.
I've got a discharge paper from General President George Washington.
I found this sampler, which I had never seen before, but always heard about them.
My last item is a silver cup that belonged to Reverend Isaac Lesser. I don't know much about it. I have a mystery on my hands. Some amazing items, I'm really excited.
Well, it sounds like we need to get to work then.
A lot of work to do. All right, let's go. Wait, don't run. I'm at the Mack Truck Historical Museum in Allentown, Pennsylvania. I've asked John to bring in his classic truck so museum curator Don Shoemaker can give us a better idea of its history and value. We need a lot of room to look at John's truck, so we've rolled it in to one of Mack's testing hangars. Look at this. This is awesome. This is amazing. You know, it's literally everything that I was hoping it was gonna be. This is beautiful. This ain't your typical big rig. This is just beautiful. How long did it take you to restore this?
13 months.
Everything was taken care of here.
Right, yeah. The suspension, the tires, the lugs, the fuel tanks are in perfect condition.
Is there any way to take a look at the engine? I'd love to see it.
Yes, sir. There you go.
That is beautiful. This is how it would have come off the assembly line.
Yes, exactly. Okay.
Wow.
We disassembled the engine. It's painted original Mack color. This truck was completely disassembled. Every nut and bolt came off it.
The truck is immaculate. You would never believe that it served that long a period of time.
Give me some good news here. How much of a treasure are we talking about with this truck?
We have to go back to the B813 as a truck model. There were less than 1,000, probably about 930 of them built. And as best we know, we believe there's only about 30 of them that are in existence.
Wow, that's good news.
Restored.
That's rare. Yeah.
Rare.
And by far, this has to be one of the most perfect restorations.
What are we talking about as far as value?
You almost have to look at something like this as being priceless. It's hard to attach a dollar value to something that has value beyond the material value. Mm-hmm. It certainly has a lot of sentimental value to John and to anybody who would own it.
All right, with all that John has done to this, do you think this truck belongs in a museum?
Absolutely.
Well, this was all great news. Very, very fun coming in here. And you know what I'd like to do? Keys, please. What gear you put me in?
Second
gear and then low split?
Yep, there you go. There you go.
Hey, we're going. Love it. John, thanks so much for letting me have this opportunity to come out here and drive a true American icon. We can drive off into the sunset here. This heavy hauler is definitely in the running, but I have two more items to investigate, so I'm gonna keep on trucking.
We're at the Johnson Victrola Museum, and we're hoping that Ann Baker Horsey, the curator of collections, can give us some more details on John's graphophone.
My grandmother passed away in 1988. We found it in her attic, and I really don't know much about it. So I really am looking forward to learning more about the graphophone and finding out what it's worth and what it meant to us as a society.
Aha. Isn't it beautiful?
This is the horn.
That's right. Well, you have, it looks like to me, you have what would be a Type B. It was known as the Eagle.
And it originally cost about $10. Mm-hmm. And it was symbolic with a $10 gold coin. Huh. This was the American Graphophone Company's desire to get a machine out affordable to everybody.
Interesting.
And they wanted to have one in every single family's home.
Huh. What time period are we talking about here?
This is 1897. Mm-hmm. The condition of the case is overall very good. However, there is one loss here in the veneer. The decal is all there. That is always
it's
nice.
It's always amazed me how beautiful that looks.
Yes. The machine itself, there's a little bit of abrasion on the turn crank and a little bit on your mandrel. However, those I think could be rubbed out a little bit. Your reproducer's in good condition, and you do have your 3-ball governor. Some of the original finish is coming off a little bit, but here again, it's all there. But everything else seems to be really in good shape.
You know, Anne, one of the questions that John had was, where was the machine made? And we know it says New York and Paris on there, but is this where it was produced?
It was actually made in Bridgeport, Connecticut, where they had their manufacturing plant.
Interesting.
Yes. I think there were something like 150,000 of them made at the time because they were so popular.
Great story behind this little machine. It's just not as rare as I had hoped. Can I ask you about the value of this?
Well, museum curators can't give values or appraisals, but we can certainly help you find out for yourself.
I appreciate that.
Let's take a look. The Bee Eagle, good condition.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Can I ask you about the value of this? Curt and I are in Delaware on the hunt for America's lost treasure. We've narrowed our search to 6 items, but only one will be chosen to go on display at the National Geographic Museum. I'm at the Johnson Victrola Museum, where curator Ann Baker Horsey has just informed me that John's 1897 graphophone is unfortunately quite common. But hopefully, still worth a pretty penny. Let's take a look. The Bee Eagle, good condition.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
$500.
Yeah. How about that?
That's great. Not that you would ever sell this.
No, it really is a family heirloom.
They're part of our cultural history. They're very important to tell our story
about
recorded sound. And this little instrument is very special for that reason. And
that's wonderful.
It's a gem.
It's a great piece of American nostalgia. It's just not unusual enough to be an American treasure.
Jack and Iris brought in a beautiful silver cup that belonged to a Reverend Isaac Leeser. So I arranged to meet with Rabbi Beals at the congregation Beth Shalom. So hopefully he'll be able to tell me more about the cup and Reverend Isaac Leeser.
The silver cup is a very special item. It's special because my father was a very religious Jewish person.
We're hoping that Curt will be able to find out a little more of the history of the person whose name is on the cup.
I really hope this turns out to be something special. And I know you are the man to tell me. So there it is.
Oh, it's magnificent. Oh my goodness.
Jack and Iris received this from his father, and they don't know much about it. They don't know Reverend Isaac
Leeser.
They hope this Reverend Leeser was somebody important, so.
He was.
Tell me about him.
Oh, incredible guy. And it's the late 1820s. This guy, Leeser, he invented the idea that on the Sabbath, a rabbi should give a sermon. Never existed before.
Never done before.
Mm-mm. This guy's incredible. He was a visionary. He gets the first Sunday school going. There had never been a Jewish Sunday school in the history of this country. He translates the 5 books of Moses for the first time into English.
So this guy's, he's making waves. He's getting stuff done
here. He's a pioneer.
Okay, so it says Reverend Isaac Leeser on here.
He had the title Reverend because there was no place ordaining people as rabbis in the United States. It's going to happen in the late 1880s. He dies in 1868, but let me tell you the coolest thing about this guy. At the time of the Civil War, there were about 150,000 Jews living in the United States.
Wow.
10,000 of them fight in the Civil War. But when they start fighting, 7,000 for the Union side, If anything happens to a Jewish person, soldier, there's no clergy person to see to their needs. And so he wrote in 1862, it's in the Library of Congress, this passionate letter to Abraham Lincoln saying, you know, just as other people who are religious have people from their faith tradition to help them, Jewish people need that as well. And to Abraham Lincoln's credit, he goes ahead and speaks to the Surgeon General and says, we need this to happen. And they make it happen.
That is phenomenal.
He just changed the face and direction of not just the Jewish community, but the entire United States of America.
This goblet or wine chalice or cup?
Kiddush cup.
Kiddush cup?
Yes.
Okay, what would this have been used for? When would this have been pulled out?
At times of sanctification, like the Holy Sabbath, Shabbat. Every Friday night, Lisa would have hopefully had guests to his home, or maybe he would have done it right in the synagogue, and he would have poured some kosher wine in it, and he would have sanctified God's name with a kiddush to bring in Friday night.
Playing a key role in the Reverend's life and practice makes this cup special, but does it make it valuable?
What value does this cup have?
You need to know that Reverend Isaac Leeser ritual objects, there's not a lot of them out there. So it's pretty rare, and my experts tell me that this Kiddush cup is valued at between $75,000 and $80,000.
Wow. Are you kidding me?
I keep your language clean, you're in my synagogue, but yes.
$75,000 to $80,000. I think Jack and Iris are going to flip.
No, they're gonna plot.
They're gonna plot.
They're gonna plot.
Is that another?
It's flipping for Jewish people.
Glenn, our expert, asked me to meet him here at Kelly's Logan House, a bar in Wilmington, to get some more history and vital information on Betsy's liquor caddy.
The liquor chest is important to me because it's a connection to the past, to know if our family story is valid, that it traveled with my great-grandfather during the Civil War, just makes it very special to us.
Hi, Glenn.
Good morning, Kinga. How are you?
I am good.
Good to see you there.
So Betsy brought this in, and it has a really interesting story. Apparently, it's a liquor caddy.
Correct.
And it was owned by her ancestor, Walter Butts, mm-hmm. who was a lieutenant colonel during the Civil War. And the best part of the story is that, one, he, I guess, had this caddy with him, and two, he was not very well liked.
That's what I found out. Actually, he was in Hood's brigade out of Texas during the Civil War. This brigade actually traveled through all the major battles that the Confederates were in. I think what is the reason that his men sort of despised him is
because he didn't share his liquor?
Well, that very well could have been too. But I think he was just a tough, hard-nosed leader. These guys fought tough battles all the time out of one into another. And, you know, he just drove them. And he actually ended up being wounded in early 1862. He did end up in the hospital, developed an infection, and had to retire from the war at that point. Went back to Houston, became a prominent lawyer and things like that. So.
Bringing his liquor caddy with taking him, probably.
Taking his liquor caddy with him, yes.
Walter Botts may have been tough on his men, but he sure went easy on his liquor caddy. It's in great condition. I had never seen anything like this before.
Okay, well, they were for travel. This probably had some cordials. This little rack in the back here with a slot probably was made for a couple glass cordials that actually locked into that for the travel part. So when you set up in the evening or whatever for your drink, you had, you know, cordial or glasses with
it. It was like a liquor picnic basket.
There you go.
And it's so beautifully done, too. Yes. Like, you have all this inlaid wood, which is just gorgeous.
Beautiful. And nice walnut cabinet. Has the original wallpapering, which they did in all the trunks of that time. Very, very nice craftsmanship. What is really neat about this is with the six bottles, a lot of these caddies had 2 to 4 bottles. So, I mean, this is unusual there.
So that makes it unique already, that it has that, six instead of
that
four.
That adds a little bit to it here.
Okay, it's pretty rare. But is it valuable?
As a historical piece, this is a great, great find. I mean, this is unreal. I mean, you know, we're looking at a value, probably conservatively, as a historical piece, this is a great, great find. I mean, this is unreal. I mean, you know, we're looking at a value, probably conservatively, $2,500 to $3,500.
Really?
Because of the provenance, you know, with him in the Civil War, a Confederate soldier.
Now that's a lot of proof the liquor caddy is a possible treasure. And Dave the bartender is going to help us celebrate.
What is this?
This is Irish whiskey.
Irish whiskey.
Irish whiskey.
Dear goodness, man.
It's a shot. It's not a sipper. Now, come on. There you go. Okay.
Well, I'm on my way now to the Moland House to meet with Stephen Rabb, who's an expert in historical documents. And he's going to take a look at these discharge papers signed by George Washington that Jim brought in.
Here's a soldier who's fought for our freedom and independence, and we don't know who it is. So I'm hoping that Curt was able to decipher the name and tell us more about who this really is.
How you doing, Stephen? Thanks for meeting me here.
Curt, pleasure to meet you. We're in a very historic building.
What is this?
We're meeting in George Washington's headquarters at a crucial moment of the Revolutionary War.
Wow.
This is the Council of War Room.
Uh-huh.
And Washington had a table, and his 13 generals were with him, and they had a meeting about what needed to be done at a very difficult and precarious time in the Revolutionary War.
Well, awesome. I got a piece here that I think is a piece of Washington history. What's the first thing you look for?
He's not going to be signing George Washington. It's going to be G. Washington, and it's going to be a huge, just flowing, masterful signature. This is interesting. The pen, of course, they used a quill, and here you can see drops of ink as he started after he had dipped the pen, and you like seeing that.
I like it a lot.
And we'll bring in this other framed piece. Okay. Now, I chose this to bring because it is signed by Washington three times. The way he had the kind of upside down or half moon at the bottom of the G, not like we would today, but kind of looping it around in the opposite way. And look how the N, the second part of the N, is lower than the top part. All these are idiosyncratic tidbits that are hard to forge.
Sure.
That mark a person's authentic handwriting. And here you have all of them, and in this document too. I mean, they are all right there.
Great. I think this is awesome news. Yes, we're on a roll. Now let's see if we can identify this mysterious soldier.
Let me see if I can come up with an answer for you here.
I can tell the first name is William.
It's so difficult to read old handwriting sometimes.
Yeah, it is. It's Somethingenberg.
I think this last name is Riedenberg. The Riedenberg family was a Dutch family in New York, and it says right here that he was in the 1st New York Regiment. So that's a confirmation. This is William Riedenberg.
William, is it Vredenberg?
V-R, yes.
Okay.
I see that he was in the army for 6 years, which is a really long time. Well, his unit is interesting. These guys were at Yorktown with Washington. So they saw the surrender of Cornwallis and the victorious end of the Revolutionary War. So this gentleman would have been present at the elation of the victory in the war after 6 years of fighting it, you know.
This is an amazing document. But how rare is it?
George Washington is the only president that signed military discharges personally.
Did every soldier receive one of these?
The only people who got these discharges had served in the Continental Army for years. These were people who were in for 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years. And so when the Revolution ended, Washington wanted those men to know that he was personally grateful for their service. So I doubt that there are more than 50 of them in circulation.
Okay, one last question. If this were to come up in auction, what do you think something like this would go for?
I would say this is a $20,000 document.
Wow.
So you can tell Jim that this is not only a wonderful piece of history and a treasure, but a very valuable one as well.
$20,000.
That's right.
20 grand is a lot of money. But more importantly, this discharge paper was personally signed by George Washington to honor one of the original American heroes. That's what really makes this an American treasure.
I'm taking John's sampler to meet with Amy Finkel, who's an expert in antique samplers. And I'm hoping that Amy will be the one to give me more insight and then also tell me that it is something that belongs in a museum.
Looking forward to finding out whether the sampler is really a special piece, whether it's unusual and outstanding among samplers. This is something that I'd like to know.
Aesthetics drives the market, so that a sampler with a well-developed house and lawn scene with animals and people and birds and baskets and trees is always more desirable. A highly terrific, very significant sampler just recently sold at a very high-end auction for just over $1 million.
Okay, what? $1 million?
Just over $1 million. Certainly more likely an average sampler might be worth in the even $500 to $5,000 range.
Now that I have a better understanding of the history and significance of these samplers, it makes me even more excited to take a look at this one.
In with good color, strong workmanship throughout, a verse that is wonderful. It's actually a good classic sampler verse, and I will read it to you because
Please.
I know it well. Count that day lost whose low descending sun views from thy hand no worthy action done. Well, how terrific is that? So if a day passed and she didn't do something worthy with her hands, we're not counting that day. So
do you see some of the same verses appear
again and again, again and again? Really extraordinary border throughout.
And do you pay attention to the stitch to see if it was done with the same hand?
Yes, so you can get a sense, absolutely, that one hand was responsible for the entire composition. Now, what's interesting here, this is really very interesting. Mary Harrington's work, wrought in the 12th year of her age, the way each individual word is put into its own little framework, or cartouche, it might be called, but very unusual, highly unusual. I have only ever seen that done once before.
How does this sampler compare to some of the other ones you've seen?
The quality of the workmanship, the aesthetics, the pictorial nature of it, the way each of her words is cartouched, the vocabulary of stitches that she was able to make use of and do so well throughout her sampler is pretty unusual.
What would you appraise this at?
I would give it a range. Can I give it a range?
Give me a range.
Give you a range.
What would you appraise this at?
I would give it a range. Can I give it a range?
Give me a range.
Give you a range. The appraisal of this that I would give in a range would be $20,000 to $25,000.
What? That's great.
It's a wonderful sample.
Wow. I'm taking up needlepoint. We have great history, authentic, wonderful value. Mary Harrington would be so proud.
She would be so, she should be so proud.
We're back at the historic Winterthur Museum in Wilmington, Delaware. Kinga and I will each present a finalist to the National Geographic Society. Ultimately, just one collector will have their treasure selected for display in Washington, D.C. We've narrowed it down to two items each. Now we have to make some tough decisions. Let me tell you a little bit about what I found out about William Vredenburgh.
Vredenburgh.
Okay. He was there when General Cornwallis of the British Army surrendered
there. Wow.
We were able to authenticate this signature as an original George Washington
Terrific.
Signature.
Oh, that's great.
With it being in this condition, the value comes in on this at up to
$20,000. Well, goodness, that's all right.
It's authentic, it's real, it's amazing. I'm going to gently hand this back to you.
Well, I'm glad to meet William Vredenburgh.
I mean, yes.
He's been in our home for so long. It's just, it's delightful to have him real.
I'm glad I could introduce you to.
Thank you.
Betsy, thank you for letting me take the liquor caddy. I have to tell you, I had a lot of fun with it. Interestingly enough, our expert was really excited about Walter Both, your ancestor, mm-hmm. and said that if this indeed did travel with Mr. Both during the Civil War, that would add some real provenance to this. And it's just a great family story. And as far as value, he appraised it at between $2,500 and $3,500.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah, yeah. Not that you should ever get rid of it.
Oh, my goodness.
Now, for our purposes, it's not the piece that I'm looking for, mm-hmm. but The fact is that you have a spectacular and unique piece that you should hang on to and just really treasure in your family.
Thank you. That means a lot to me. It'll mean a lot to my family.
Good.
Thank you.
And now it's time to find out which object will be chosen as America's lost treasure.
My sampler is one of the finalists. It's a wonderful thing.
Honey, if our grandchildren could see us now, they wouldn't believe it.
Wait a minute. If my Mahjong group could see me now.
My stomach is jumping up and down.
Hi, folks. How are you?
Oh, it's so good to see you.
Well, everyone, we have two amazing items here. Unfortunately, only one of them can go on display at the National Geographic Museum in Washington, D.C. So we have to pick one.
Yes, and the owner of the chosen item will get a chance to share their lost treasure with the world.
Fortunately, the weight of that burden does not fall just on mine and Kurt's shoulders. We also have Greg Magruder here from National Geographic to help us make this very difficult choice. Yes. Greg, let me introduce you to John Fredland. And what John has brought in is this beautiful sampler made by one of his ancestors. Basically, what I've learned is that this is an incredible piece of social history. Now, this one in particular was made by Mary Harrington in 1803. We took it over to M. Finkel and daughter. Amy Finkel took a look at it. She said it was beautifully done, beautifully preserved. And this one is worth about $20,000 to $25,000.
Great.
Yeah.
This is absolutely gorgeous. I've never quite seen a sampler like this. So on to you, Curt.
You ready?
I'm ready for you.
Good. Well, this is Jack and Iris Vinegar.
Hey.
How are you?
How are
Wonderful
you?
To meet
great,
you.
They brought in this silver cup, and what we know about it is that, one, it's made of silver, and on the front there's an engraving that says, to Reverend Isaac Leeser. And what I was able to find out about Reverend Isaac Leeser is pretty amazing. He is probably one of the most important figures in the American Jewish community here in the 19th century, if not the most important. And I found out that it was a Kiddush cup that I almost converted. I learned so much. Because items directly related to Isaac Leeser are so rare, this particular Kiddush cup was appraised at $80,000. So. Well, that is it. I've been schwitzing all day over this. I didn't want to go mashug in front of this mention that get tomato, but it's all showing now, so we're good.
These are both amazing objects, but we can only select one for the National Geographic Museum. And the object that we're going to select is going to be the cup.
Here we go.
What we're looking for are objects that reflect American history in unique ways. And the person who originally owned this cup, having connections with Abraham Lincoln, is, how much more special can it get than that?
Wow. Catch her if you can.
I got you.
If my dad was here today, he'd be extremely proud of his family, of what this cup represents.
It's original.